Hi, everyone, and welcome to another episode of Wellness Day, a podcast coming to every Wednesday here from the Jehangir Wellness Center. My name is Kavas Jehangir, and here from the JWC studio, I'm joined today by Dr. Shriniwas Ambike, who is one of the leading nephrologists here in Pune and at our hospital at Jehangir Hospital. So thank you so much for being here, Dr. Ambike.
Thank you, Kavas. Thank you so much. My pleasure.
First question we can answer, because myself included until a while ago at least, is that what is nephrology?
Nephrology is a scientific term where we talk about diseases of the kidneys pertaining to the, basically the functioning aspect of the kidneys is right. What a nephrologist does.
Okay.
So you to keep your kidneys healthy.
Right.
Prevent them from getting worse, how to take care of them is all that we do as a nephrologist.
Right.
Once they start deteriorating in function, we try and prevent as much as we can.
Right.
And that is what the purview of a nephrologist would be.
Is. Yeah. So why is the kidney so important?
It's one of the major organs which purifies the blood.
Okay.
All our excretory products.
Right.
The metabolism is going on every minute.
Mm.
And there are a lot of waste products which are coming up into the system.
Right.
So kidneys, all of us know, is the major excretory organ.
Mm.
Apart from that, a few things which are not known about the kidneys is it is an endocrine organ as well.
Okay, what does that mean?
Endocrine meaning it secretes some hormones.
Okay.
All of us know insulin, all of us know thyroid.
Right.
All of us know about the growth hormone, the pituitary.
Right, okay.
So there are a few hormones which are secreted by the kidneys, which, you rightly thought, are not really very much aware of. So,
okay.
Erythropoietin is an hormone which is required for the formation of hemoglobin.
Okay.
Also, it has a major role in taking care of the bones, meaning your bones might start becoming brittle.
Okay.
So, that way, these are the two factors or two other functions which, apart from their excretory function,
right.
They also take care in the management or in the controlling of the blood pressure. Maintaining
blood
a normal blood pressure,
People always think that that would come from the heart.
No, blood pressure is a disease of the kidneys.
Because
the handling of the sodium,
right.
Once that goes haywire, you start having a rise in blood pressure. And basically, it is the beginning of a kidney disease.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, actually, that's a good segue, coming to kidney disease. What are the most common kidney diseases?
As I rightly said just now, meaning the commonest cause of kidney disease is diabetes. Unfortunately,
right.
India is now becoming a global capital of diabetes.
Mm.
Most of our patients are either diabetic or hypertensive.
Right.
Apart from these two well-known factors, there are certain other congenital diseases which can affect the kidneys, like polycystic kidney disease, which would account for about 5 to 10%.
Okay.
Then there are certain primary kidney diseases which can happen during childhood.
Right.
And if they go unattended or unnoticed, they would worsen to a stage of chronic kidney disease.
I see. But coming
by and large, the diabetes and hypertension would probably account for almost about 50% of
exactly.
all my
which is why patients. That's why I was going to actually ask about the diabetes. You're saying that that's something that's increasing.
It's increasing.
But why is it happening, especially in India?
It's basically because of the lifestyle that has changed over a period of time.
Right.
If you go to see, it was quite a simple lifestyle that our forefathers or our
population
had. Now it is a part of the civilization or the affluency that is coming into the picture.
Okay.
Also, we are having what is called as syndrome X. We have central obesity, hypertriglyceridemias.
Yeah, yeah.
All that adds to the diabetes and the diabetic kidney disease.
I suppose one of the biggest things is the access to, things like processed food and so forth
that
is
also,
becoming...
Yeah, meaning the entire lifestyle has changed.
Yeah. Oh, we're becoming more sedentary also.
Westerners, we are following the Western pattern of living, so
right.
processed foods, lack of exercise, sedentary lifestyle,
right.
all that is adding to the increased incidence of diabetes and thereby increasing the diabetic kidney disease.
Right. And while we're still on diabetes, because it's obviously a very big topic, I always get confused between type 1 and type 2. So what is the difference?
It was being labeled as type 1, type 2. Now it is customary to say it as insulin dependent diabetes and non-insulin dependent diabetes.
That's easier to understand.
So I mean that probably answers.
Yeah.
Type 1 was the one which was insulin dependent, which usually occurs at a younger age.
Okay.
There is an absolute deficiency of insulin in the individual or in the patient.
So they can't make it.
So they cannot make their own. So okay. They are likely to remain on insulin lifelong.
Right.
As against that, type 2 is the one which is non-insulin dependent. Hmm. So they have insulin resistance, so as to say, or right. Circulating insulin, in fact, is higher in their circulation.
Okay.
And they develop what is called as insulin resistance to a lot of other factors.
Okay.
Yeah. So they could be controlled with diet, with oral hypoglycemic agents and lifestyle measures.
Okay. Which is actually was going to be my next question. You're answering my questions before I can ask them, which is a good thing. You're ahead of the game. No, so actually, that's a question I was going to ask, is that these kind of diseases, particularly diabetes, what are the kind of things that we can do to prevent them? Or one step, or I suppose, yeah, the first question would be what we can do to prevent them. And then the second step or second part of the question would be, is that what are the early signs that we can look at to try and
to prevent them, meaning you need to have a healthy lifestyle. Mm-hmm. As you rightly pointed out earlier in your last question, that stop taking processed foods, take a healthy Indian diet, I suppose, is probably the best diet.
Right.
Then regular exercise, avoid smoking, avoid alcohol. Alcohol in moderation is permitted, but by and large, if you avoid that, and a regular exercise, diet, that would probably prevent it from getting worse, even if someone gets to have diabetes. Right.
But let's come back to, because these are things that, as you said, are completely correct and known. But I just want to particularly go into the smoking one, because people always associate that with lung or, lung-related things.
Lung and cardiovascular risk factor.
Exactly. Yeah. How have you seen it actually being adverse in the kidney particularly?
It does affect the kidney disease also.
Right.
It is basically most of the blood vessels start getting affected for someone who has been a smoker for a long period of time.
Right.
It worsens the atherosclerotic disease that is a generalized atherosclerosis. And so even for kidney disease, we advise to avoid smoking totally.
Right. And can you, in your experience, when you see kidney reports or kidney scans, can you immediately tell when someone's a smoker?
Not really. Oh.
But then they're associated.
But then we always go into the history and try and find out exactly what the habits are. So that's it. Reports don't tell us.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, so then they can hide for only a short period of time.
That's right. Yeah.
Moving to other aspects of the kidney. Kidney stones is another big thing that people get and talk about. Yeah. One is, how do they get them?
As I mentioned, that is one of the causes of chronic kidney disease.
Okay.
Basically, there are a few hereditary metabolic factors which predisposes someone to having kidney stones.
Okay.
Especially so if the water that someone is consuming, if it is a hard water where the solutes or the salts that are there, basically the calcium salts, the oxalates, if they are there in a high percentage, then they get deposited in the kidneys and that forms a nidus for them to grow as kidney stones.
Okay.
So also if someone is not taking an adequate water intake.
Right.
And if someone is passing a very concentrated urine,
mm-hmm.
that will again predispose someone to stones. So,
okay.
And of course, there is some amount of familial or a hereditary predisposition to forming stones.
Right. But I guess that comes back to what you were just mentioning, is that the importance of hydration.
Hydration, yeah.
So how much water should someone be having every day?
For a normal, healthy individual who does not have any kidney problems, of course, we are not talking about kidney disease as such.
Yeah.
So on an average, everyone should probably pass around 1.5 to 2 liters of urine, which would probably go into around 2.5 to 3 liters of water intake,
okay.
Which would make you pass around 3 liters, 2.5 liters of urine.
So how do you tell people, because there's always people saying, I can't drink so much water in the day.
What I always do is, sorry. You,
yeah, yeah. No,
I mean,
so
I got your question.
That?
Yeah.
Yeah.
See, I keep a liter of water, 1 liter bistleri water in my OPD. And the 3-4 hours that I'm there, that is finished. That just gets over. When you're traveling in a car, you can keep a water bottle by the side.
Right.
And as you are either driving or you're sitting by the side, keep drinking water.
Yeah.
Because that is a habit that you need to form.
Right. Absolutely.
And most of us are now indoors. We don't go into the sun. So we wouldn't be feeling thirsty.
Yeah, that's a good point.
We are indoors. We are
you think
having,
that you're okay.
Yeah, exactly. We are in the AC.
Right.
And that by itself probably reduces the intake of water.
And no, I felt that benefit to myself because I never used to have that much water. But when I actually actively started doing that and having 2 to 3 liters a day, I found that my energy was much
more energetic.
Better.
Absolutely.
Your bowels are
everything
well.
Everything is set right.
Yeah, exactly. I can't describe how much of a difference it actually made overall. So it's definitely a benefit.
Of late, I think this needs to be mentioned to the patients, meaning you need to ask them, do you consume enough water?
Yeah.
Everyone's concept about what is enough is different.
Right.
So you need to tell them that you carry a liter of water at your workplace.
Uh-huh.
You see to it that you finish it by the time that you come back home.
Yeah.
And it's a good habit to take, say, either a half a glass or about 500 ml of water once you wake up in the morning.
Yeah.
Which I've been doing myself and which I advise my patients also.
Okay.
So that keeps the concentration of the urine less.
Right, right.
This we are talking about normal individuals.
Yeah,
of course. If someone who has
a
kidney disease, it is going to be what the nephrologist advises. Yeah, exactly.
But is there anything like overhydration?
As long as your kidneys are working well, they take care of whatever water that you consume.
Okay.
But if someone has a kidney disease, someone's kidneys are not functioning optimal.
Right.
Then obviously that would weigh upon. That would be decided upon how much of urine that individual is passing.
Okay.
Because as the kidney function worsens, the kidneys have a fixed amount of urine that they can be passing.
I see.
So if someone has a kidney failure and his output is not going to get beyond 1.5 liters, then there's no point in expecting him to consume 3 liters because those 1.5 liters are going to remain in his system.
Which
would add to his, he'll become puffed up. He starts swelling of the feet.
Right.
He starts getting breathless.
Right.
So that is what it is.
Okay. But what about, we've been talking about input and output of urine.
Yeah.
You know, people sometimes can get, foamy urine or really dark colored.
That is the beginning of a kidney disease. Mm-hmm. Foamy urine is, again, it may be because of a concentrated urine, but that is the earliest sign that there is some amount of protein leakage in the urine. And that is the earliest marker of a kidney disease.
Oh, interesting. So
also, if your urine is not concentrated,
it
should not be very high colored.
Mm-hmm.
And appearance of, say, either a reddish tinge or some kind of a blood in the urine
does
indicate that someone needs to see a nephrologist.
Okay. But it's good that, that's the beauty of the body. It gives you earlier
signs. Yeah, that's
right. So the point is to be vigilant and then address.
You have to be watchful on the signals that your body is giving.
Yeah. So it's actually not a bad thing that it's happening. It's a good thing that it's happening early. So you have to keep an eye on that. But coming back to hydration, and we were talking about kidney stones, a very popular remedy is, can I have lots of beer when I have kidney stones? Is that true?
I thought you would ask me that. Beer is like water. It's a what do you say? A pretext for someone to justify that since I am having stones, I should drink a lot of beer. Nothing more, someone says that you drink a lot of barley water. Now, I don't know whether you would get barley water very easily.
Yeah, exactly. Well, kidney stones can be painful, so maybe they treat it like a painkiller.
It may be acting as a painkiller. It probably knocks you off and you get away from the pain that you get from the stones.
Well, any other common myths that people come to you for kidney-related or blood-related things that you would like to...
One more thing amongst the younger generation that we see is everyone wants to have a very good physique, a very good shape.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of people consume these kind of protein supplements.
Okay.
The creatine powder and all.
Right.
So that is probably not necessary. It should be avoided. It does harm your kidneys.
Right.
You can see a dietitian and he or she would probably advise you the natural sources of protein. So amongst the teenagers and amongst the younger people, you get to see a lot of people consuming these hi-fi protein powders and protein shakes that they are.
I suppose the right thing is to have the right, the right ingredients.
Yeah, ingredients, yeah.
And,
exactly.
Right
and
sources.
And natural sources.
And natural sources.
Sources should be,
And I suppose if you're hydrated enough also, this can be
controlled.
Because I've also read enough spoken to a lot of nutritionists and people who are into exercise and doctors who are saying that it's not particularly bad for you as long as you're doing it in moderation.
In moderation,
as you correctly said, under supervision of proper
dietitian
and so forth. So that's also good to know.
Yeah.
Well, Doc, it's been extremely fascinating hearing from you about all aspects of the kidney and blood. Any last thoughts that you'd like to leave us with in terms of the importance of kidney health and how we should be treating it?
Yeah, unfortunately, kidney diseases are on the rise, primarily because of the changing lifestyle, the increasing incidence of diabetes, hypertension. Anyone who is detected to have hypertension, diabetes, should regularly get the kidney parameters. And as I said, the earliest marker for a kidney disease is appearance of urine, proteins in the urine.
Right.
So once in 6 months, if someone has been a diabetic for, let's say, about 5 years or longer, should get their renal parameters done. See to it that their HbA1c, their fasting sugars, PP sugars are well under control. Avoid non-vegetarian diet. Keep yourself well hydrated. And
that's such an easy one. Keep yourself hydrated. It seems to be like one of the most important things with
kidney. But then that needs to be highlighted again and again.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Avoid non-vegetarian, especially red meat. Egg white and fish is permitted. Red meat does affect or adversely affect the kidneys.
Yeah. But hopefully not too much.
Sorry?
Hopefully not too much.
Not too much. salt in moderation.
Yeah.
That again adds to the hypertension, which is like a sequelae of kidney disease, and by itself, if it is not controlled, it worsens the kidney damage.
It's a snowball effect.
Right. So, all these things, and if someone is detected with some amount of kidney ailment, then it is better to be in touch with your nephrologist, see him on a regular basis, and take care as much as possible, because most of the kidney diseases are progressive in nature.
Right.
So, it is better to avoid them coming in rather than waiting for the eventuality.
Prevention is always
better than cure. Yeah,
absolutely. Well, thank you again so much for being here, Doc.
It's been an absolute pleasure having you. Thank you.
Thank you all, and see you again for next week's episode. But before you go, please don't forget to hit the like and subscribe button right at the bottom over here. Thank you.